If you have your Bibles, I invite you to open them with me today to Luke's Gospel, chapter 7. Luke's Gospel, chapter number 7. Before we get into the text, though, let me just say a word of appreciation this morning on such a rough weather day. I appreciate our parking lot detail and those guys that drive the little cart around and pick people up and saw them out there with their rain jackets and hats on, and we appreciate them so very much. And also, I want to thank our maintenance team for running around and mopping up water, because trust me, it was everywhere. You know, we have a lot of roofs on a lot of buildings on this church campus, and I think that practically every one of them leaks. We have had new roofs put on, and yet wherever you go, you find water leaking. So if you want something specifically to pray about, pray, God, stop the leaks. Just stop the leaks in our roof. But we do appreciate them so very much in helping us to be able to have our worship service today. How would you complete the sentence, "The gospel of Jesus Christ is"? How would you complete that? Maybe you would say, well, the gospel of Jesus Christ is God's love message to humanity. Or you might say, the gospel of Jesus Christ, it's the greatest news ever told. Or you might say, the gospel of Jesus Christ is the hope for the world. And certainly all of those explanations, all of the completions of that sentence, they are unquestionably true. But if you were to ask me to complete that sentence, I think that I would add to it, the gospel of Jesus Christ is transformational. And the reason I know the gospel of Jesus Christ is transformational is because the Apostle Paul tells us in Romans chapter 1, verse 16, he said, "I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it," the gospel, "is the power of God unto salvation to all who believe." And that word "power" there was an interesting word that he used. It's the word "dunamis," and the word "dunamis" is our word "dynamite." So the gospel of Jesus Christ, then, it is dynamite. And if you were to take and light a stick of dynamite, drop it in this building this morning, I'll guarantee you this building would be transformed. And if we were in this building, we would be transformed as well. There's power in the gospel. The gospel transforms. As a matter of fact, it was the gospel of Jesus Christ that transformed a guy by the name of John Newton. John Newton was a wicked slave trader, and yet John Newton was transformed into a guy that wrote a gospel hymn that we love to sing those words, "Amazing grace, how sweet the sound, that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see." What transformed that wicked slave trader into a guy that wrote a hymn like that? It was the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's the gospel that transformed the life of your pastor. It's the gospel that transformed the lives of hundreds of other people gathered in churches across our world today. The gospel, there's nothing as powerful as the gospel. And I think that we could say that the gospel is both a message. It's a message defined for us by Paul in 1 Corinthians 15 when he says that here is the gospel. It's that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. He was buried and then raised again the third day according to the Scriptures. But the gospel is not only a message, the gospel is also a man. And that man's name is Jesus. And so when you and I respond by faith to the message of the gospel, the man of the gospel, who is more than a man, who is also Lord and Savior, he comes to live in our lives. And what does he do? He transforms us. There is nothing as powerful as the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so today, as we continue our study through Luke's gospel, we're in chapter 7, beginning with verse number 36, and we're going to talk about the transforming power of Jesus. Luke 7, verse 36, "Then one of the Pharisees asked him," that is Jesus, "to eat with him. And he went to the Pharisee's house, and he sat down to eat. And behold, a woman in the city who was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus sat at the table in the Pharisee's house, she brought an alabaster flask of fragrant oil and stood at his feet behind him weeping. And she began to wash his feet with her tears and wiped them with the hair of her head. And she kissed his feet and anointed them with the fragrant oil. Now when the Pharisee who had invited him, when he saw this, he spoke to himself, saying, "This man, if he were a prophet, he would know who and what manner of woman this is who is touching him, for she is a sinner." And Jesus answered and said to him, "Simon, I have something to say to you." And so he said, "Teacher, say it." He said, "There was a certain creditor who had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii, the other 50. And when they had nothing with which to repay, he freely forgave them both. Tell me, therefore, which of them will love him more?" And Simon answered and said, "I suppose the one whom he forgave more." And he said to him, "You have rightly judged." And then he turned to the woman and he said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has washed my feet with her tears, wiped them with the hair of her head. You gave me no kiss, but this woman has not ceased to kiss my feet since the time that I came in. You did not anoint my head with oil, but this woman has anointed my feet with fragrant oil. Therefore I say to you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved me much. But to whom little is forgiven, the same loves little." And then he said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." And those who sat at the table with him began to say to themselves, "Who is this who even forgives sins?" And then he said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." Now, we need to be careful here and not confuse this story with another one that is recorded of another woman anointing the feet of Jesus with some expensive oil. It's recorded back in John chapter 12. And I know that's not the same event, because that happened in John 12 in Bethany, while this is happening in Galilee. And we also need to not confuse this lady, like some commentators do, with Mary Magdalene, because it is a completely different lady. But within this story, I think it's one of the best that we have in the Gospels that show us the transforming power of Jesus. Now, the first thing that I want to highlight, found down in verse number 36, is what I'm simply referring to as a strange invitation, from this Pharisee to Jesus to come into his house. And when we begin to look at that invitation, the first thing that we notice is the callousness of the Pharisee. Now we really do not know why this Pharisee invited Jesus to come into his house. It was something back in those days that was quite common, that if a famous rabbi or teacher were passing through town, that someone would invite them into their home and give them an opportunity to teach God's word. Now, we don't know exactly why this Pharisee did this, because Pharisees didn't like Jesus. Everything that Jesus taught, the Pharisees, they were against. So for whatever reason the Pharisee invited Jesus into his house, I'll guarantee you it was not for noble purposes. And the reason I would say that is because of what is said down in verse number 44 through 46, when it says that Jesus then turned to the woman and said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet. She's washed my feet with her tears and wiped them with the hair of her head. You gave me no kiss, but this woman has not ceased to kiss my feet since the time I came in. You did not anoint my head with oil, but this woman, she has anointed my feet with fragrant oil." In other words, the Lord Jesus was not treated with the common courtesies that every guest would have been treated with. It was common back in those days when a guest came into the house, especially if they were invited as a guest lecturer or a rabbi or a teacher, that the host of the home would take and put his hands on the shoulders of the guest and would give them the kiss of peace. Well, Jesus didn't receive that, and that's what he was referring to when he said, "You gave me no kiss." It was also common in those days when the guests would come in. They had been walking down the dusty road, and so they would either at the entrance of the house or the banquet hall, or either as they reclined at the table to eat, the sandals would be removed from the feet, and those feet would be washed. And they would be, it would be a sense of trying to refresh the one who had come as the guest. But Jesus wasn't afforded any of that. In fact, when you read the story, you see that they did absolutely nothing to try to make Jesus welcome and to feel at home when he arrived in the banquet hall. Now, make no mistake, everybody that was gathered that day, they would take note of this, and they would see how Jesus was being treated. Now listen, Jesus knew exactly how he was going to be treated, but Jesus went anyway. And that's one of the amazing things about this story, is that Jesus knew what was in store for him, and yet he attended the banquet hall anyway. Now, we could spend the rest of the day talking about the callousness of the Pharisee. What I really want to hone in on is the concern of Jesus. Yes, there was the callousness of the Pharisee, but there was also the concern of Jesus. Now, I am not sure if I were invited to an event and I knew that I was going to be purposefully embarrassed, that I would attend that event. And you see, everybody, as they looked at Jesus with his dirty, uncovered feet, that would be an embarrassing thing. If I knew that was going to happen to me, I don't think I would go. And yet Jesus did. And the question is, why? Knowing what he knew, knowing he would be embarrassed, knowing he would be ill-treated, why did he go into that banquet hall? For one reason, his concern. Now, normally when we read this story, our entire focus is upon the sinful woman and what Jesus did for her. But I think we see an amazing thing here about the Lord Jesus, because not only was he concerned for the sinful woman, he was also concerned for the sinful Pharisee. See, the Bible says that Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost. And the Lord Jesus was just as concerned for this religious lost man who thought he was saved as he was for this sinful woman who knew that she was lost. That's why he went into that home. It was because of his concern. And he went there for the purpose of evangelizing not only the woman, but also the Pharisee. And what is so interesting to me is that the methodology that Jesus would use here to evangelize the Pharisee was by transforming the life of a woman that the Pharisee despised. You see, Pharisees despise people like this. I mean, Pharisees would kick them out of the culture if they possibly could have. And yet the Lord Jesus transformed her life right before his very eyes. That was a tool of evangelizing. And you know, when I think about that, there is so much evidence for the truthfulness of Christianity. There's the evidence of science. There's the evidence of history. There's the evidence of fulfilled prophecy. But I want to tell you, the greatest evidence there is for the truthfulness of Christianity is the transformation of lives of those who have been redeemed by the grace of God. And anyone today who rejects Christianity, they have to stumble over the evidence of transformed lives. How else do we explain the mighty transformation that occurs in people's lives who come to Christ, other than the fact that Christianity is real? It's true. It works. Jesus, the Son of God, changes lives. The power of Jesus Christ. So we see the concern of Jesus. We see this strange invitation, but we also see the sinful woman. The sinful woman. Now, it was customary in those days. Now, get this. It was customary that when an important person in town threw a party, held a banquet, it was always held in an outdoor courtyard. And this would explain how this woman got access to Jesus. Because this woman, if she would have just come up and knocked on the front door, I'll guarantee you the servant that answered the door never would have let her in. But it was such a situation where there was an outdoor courtyard, and the people would be gathered there. And then all of the outsiders that weren't invited, they would gather around as closely as they could so that they could put their eyes on, quote, the important people and eavesdrop on their conversation. And that's the only explanation as to how it was that this woman got into the courtyard and gained an audience with Jesus. See, she never would have been let in because, number one, she was a woman. Jewish rabbis in those days, they didn't speak to women in public. That was just a no-no. That tells you how they thought about women. There's a second thing. Not only was she a woman, she was a woman of the streets. When we read between the lines, we discover that she was a prostitute. She sold her body in that town, and everybody knew what her history was and what her reputation was. And so that leads us to two things here. Number one is her conversion. Her conversion. Now listen carefully. The Bible does not record in the text her conversion. It only records her worship. Now, if you're paying attention to the scripture, that alerts you to something. If it only records her worship and not her conversion, evidently this lady had been converted at some other time before she came into the banquet hall. Why is that? It is because conversion always precedes worship. Worship never precedes conversion. So this lady, evidently, somewhere, in some place, she'd heard the words of Jesus, she had accepted him into her life, she got converted, and now she comes to this place for worship. I was doing myself last week a little harmony of the Gospels, and I ran across something that's recorded over in Matthew chapter 11, which actually was the event that happened right before the event that we're reading about in Luke chapter 7. And it was an event where Jesus gave this great invitation to a great crowd of people. And you know the verses. Matthew 11, verse 28, Jesus said to this big crowd, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart. You will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light." I wonder, since that event occurred right before Luke 7, verse 36, I wonder if that's not the time that she opened up her heart to the Lord Jesus Christ and experienced the forgiveness of sins. And so when we get over to Luke chapter 7, then her tears, her humble attitude, her expensive gift, all of that is evidence of a changed heart. So her heart had already been changed. Jesus didn't change her and save her in the banquet hall. She'd already been saved and changed. And that is where we pick up on the next point, and that is her worship. Her worship in verses 37 through 39. So we see her conversion, then she comes to worship. Behold, a woman in the city who was a sinner. She knew that Jesus sat at the table at the Pharisee's house, so she brought this alabaster flask of fragrant oil, which, by the way, would have been something extremely expensive. She stood at his feet behind him, weeping. She began to wash his feet with the tears and wiped them with the hair of her head, and she kissed his feet, and she anointed them with the fragrant oil. Now, when the Pharisees who invited him saw this, he spoke to himself, saying, "This man, if he were a prophet, he would know who and what manner of woman this is who is touching him, for she is a sinner." In my personal opinion, I think this is one of the purest illustrations of real, genuine, godly worship that we find anywhere in the Bible. And what is interesting is that the Bible tells us that when this woman began to worship like that, that it embarrassed the Pharisee. He was embarrassed for himself. He was embarrassed for his guest. Here is this woman just emotionally out of control, weeping bucketfuls of tears, kissing all over the feet of Jesus, and the Pharisee is embarrassed. You know what that tells us? It tells us that anytime there is true, genuine, godly, holy, pure worship, it'll embarrass Pharisees and unsaved people. They won't like it. And the church today that tries to arrange their, quote, worship service in a way that it will not offend unsaved people, they're attempting to do something that is impossible. Friend, worship is for God's people. It's not for unsaved people. And unsaved people won't understand our heart expression. They won't understand what it is that we are doing. And the church is just barking up the wrong tree, trying to make sure that we don't offend any unsaved people by our worship. Our worship is guided by what? The Spirit of God, the Word of God, and it's for God's people. What a demonstration of worship here. We see this demonstration as we examine it, that really she came to worship out of a profound sense of gratitude to Jesus for what he'd done for her. And so here she comes, and she's just overwhelmed with a sense of gratitude. She pours out this expensive perfume on the feet of the Lord Jesus because she's so grateful. Some place and sometime, somewhere, I'm not really sure where it was or when it was, but there was a time Jesus came into her heart and he forgave her of her sins. And because of that, now she comes out of gratitude to Jesus to worship him. And her worship is seen in three things. It's seen in her tears. Her tears. Trying to put myself in that environment, trying to sit at that table in that banquet hall where Jesus was. And I think that when this lady came, and I think that when she saw Jesus, he was there, and she saw him again. Since the time that she had met him as Lord and Savior, she saw him, coupled with, I think, the fact that she was just heartbroken in the disrespectful way that Jesus was being treated. No one gave him a kiss. No one wiped down his feet. No one anointed his head. And when she saw all of that, I think that there was just this emotional outburst. And the tears began to flow like raindrops falling on the dust of the ground. And her tears falling on the feet of Jesus just streaked the soiled feet of Jesus. I don't think she meant for it to happen like that. But when she got into his presence and she saw him, that's all that she could do, was to weep. And I think standing there, she's probably thinking, you know what, I can remember it wasn't too long ago. And I was so guilty. I know I was guilty. I had broken the seventh commandment. I had prostituted my body. And I was so guilty, but now I am forgiven. And I've been walking around all these years with this heavy load of guilt on my shoulders. I was guilty, and everywhere I went, everybody let me know how guilty that I really was. Because they would point at me and they would whisper, and I knew what they were saying about who that I was. But now I'm free. Now the burden is lifted. Now the guilt is gone. Now I feel washed and clean and pure and whole. And all she could do was weep at his feet. Friend, when we understand that, how in God's name can we not worship when we see that? She had lived all of her adult life in total rejection. She was like a leper, the way the town looked at her. But now, she knew she was accepted by God. And friend, the only appropriate thing to do was to worship Him. We see her worship in her tears. We see it in her hair. And one of the reasons I believe that she did not plan this to happen, because she had no towel to dry his feet. If she'd planned to come there and just put on some kind of crocodile tears and turn the waterworks on, she'd have brought a towel to dry his feet. She didn't have a towel. So what did she do? She did something that no woman of that day would have done. She unloosed her long flowing hair and got down before his dirty feet and wiped his feet with the hair of her head. You realize how socially unacceptable that was for that culture of that day? Man, a woman didn't let down her hair in the presence of anybody but her husband. And that was in private. In fact, for a woman to unloose her hair in public was grounds for divorce. And a man could divorce her right on the spot if she were to do such a thing. But here's what I love. She didn't care what anybody thought. She was going to worship Jesus. She didn't care. She didn't care about the ridicule. She didn't care what her husband said. She didn't care about the gossiping biddies in town and what they were going to say about her. She cared only about one thing. I'm in His presence and I'm going to worship Him. Oh God, give me that kind of heart. We see it not only in her hair, but we also see it in her kisses. That word kiss there is a strong word. It's the word kataphileo. Kataphileo. What an expression of love. It was an expression of affectionate devotion. She got down and, you know, we get the idea of she just gave him a little peck on the feet. But that's not what the word means. As a matter of fact, did you know that's the same word that is used in Luke chapter 15 in the story of the prodigal son, when the son came home and the father fell on his neck and just kissed him and kissed him and kissed him and kissed him. It's the same word that is used when the apostle Paul was leaving the city of Ephesus. And the elders came together on the Isle of Miletus when Paul was leaving. And the Bible says they fell on his neck, they embraced him, and they kissed him over and over and over and over again. That's the kind of kissing that this word means. She just lavished him with kisses. It was an expression of affectionate devotion. Oh, how she loved Jesus. You realize that the greatest evidence there is for a saved life is love for God and love for God's Christ. It's love for Jesus. The greatest evidence is not church attendance. We ought to come to church. It's not tithing our income. We ought to tithe our income. It's not in a service position. We ought to serve somewhere with our spiritual gift. Greatest evidence of a saved life is love for Jesus. And the greatest expression of love for Jesus is worship. If we love Him, we are going to worship Him. But not only do we see a sinful woman, we also see a self-righteous man. Verse 39, when the Pharisee who had invited him, when he saw this, he spoke to himself, saying, "Why, this man, if he were a prophet, he would know who and what manner of woman this is who is touching him, for she is a sinner." His heart was filled with indignant judgmentalism. In other words, the Pharisee would have liked for Jesus just to kick her back to her sin, kick her back to her misery. Jesus just kick her to the curb. She's not worth anything. Friend, I want to tell you this guy's problem. He had an Arctic heart. He had a heart without any grace. She was a sinner. Everybody knew it. He had no heart for her. And he had a soul that was far, 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 far away from God. How do we know that we have a heart that is close to God? What is our heart like for sinners? Do we have a heart for sinners? Well, Jesus did, but this guy didn't. He called her a sinner. What is interesting is that it was he, the moralist, who was the great sinner. It was not her, the one who admitted that she was a sinner. It was he that crossed all the T's, dotted all the I's, had all the things of morality under control in his life. It was the moralist who was really the sinner. But then I want to tell you, old Goody Two-Shoes is about to get some instructions from Jesus. He didn't want to hear. Because Jesus then gives him a sobering illustration that would point out the deficiency of his own heart. You realize down in verse number 39, the Pharisees hadn't said a word. He was just thinking this to himself. Then Jesus comes up and gives his parable, this illustration, and it highlights exactly what he was thinking. I don't know about you, but if I'd have been the Pharisee at that point, I'd have said, I probably need to check up on turning things around. This guy's reading my mind. He knows exactly what I'm thinking. And within this parable, we see three quick things that are so important for us to understand. Number one, down in verses 41 and 42, he highlights the importance of understanding that we all owe an equal debt. An equal debt. He said there was a certain creditor who had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii, the other 50. And when they had nothing with which to repay, he freely forgave them both. So now tell me, therefore, which of them will love him more? And the word debtors here is used in a more metaphorical sense, you might say, to speak of sinners. So the two debtors are speaking of the two sinners. And the two sinners are an application to the prostitute and to the Pharisee. Now, they were in debt. They couldn't pay the debt. A denarii was equal to one day's wage. So what that would mean is that in order for one guy to retire his debt, he'd have to work for 50 days. The other guy, to retire his debt, he would have to work for 500 days. But the point of the parable is that both of them were in debt. Both of these people in this story were sinners. And I think that according to the conventional outward teaching on morality, you could say, you know, she was a 500 sinner. He was a 50 sinner. But the parable is emphasizing, now listen carefully, the important thing is not the amount of sin in the sinner's life. The important thing is the awareness of sin in the sinner's life. And you see, the woman's sins, they were of the flesh. They were known. Everybody could see them. But the Pharisee's sins, they were of the heart. And they were unknown, except to the one that matters most, and that is to God. So the Pharisee's real problem was what? It was his blindness. He could not see. He could not see himself. He could not see the woman. And he could not see Jesus because he was blind. It was easy for him to say, she is a sinner. But he could not say, I am a sinner because he was blind. An equal debt. Secondly, an equal problem. An equal problem. It's not that one was a big sinner, other was a little sinner. Now, don't we in all honesty in the church tend to take sin like that? Oh, they're a big sinner. Look at them. Look how they live. Look at their lifestyle. Big sinner. And then we put others over here in the category of being a little sinner. But what Jesus said, both of these guys in the story had a debt. And the problem was that neither one of them could pay. Now think about that for a moment. If you are in debt, And there are consequences for the debt not being paid, no matter the size of the debt. You go to jail if you don't pay the debt. It really doesn't matter if you owe $1 or if you owe $1,000. If you have no money, if you are broke, if you are bankrupt, if you can't pay the debt, it doesn't matter if it's $1 or if it is $1,000. We all have a debt. That's what Romans 3, verse 23 says. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Now, friend, that does not mean that people can't do things to improve their character or their life, but it simply means, are you listening? Say amen. It means that we have such a debt we cannot pay. We cannot pay our sin debt. The only thing that wipes out the sin debt is for God to cancel it. And the only way God cancels it is through forgiveness in Jesus Christ. It's the only thing that takes that debt away. It's not our goodness. It's not our feelings. It is not anything but the work of Christ on the cross. That's the gospel. That's the power of the gospel. Nothing else can cancel the debt but the gospel. And so that leads us to an equal solution. An equal solution. Let me tell you the amazing thing about this story. The only way that this moneylender could cancel this debt was for this moneylender to assume it himself and pay for it. That's the only way. The Bible says he forgave the debt. How? He paid it. He paid it. Do you understand what that says about God? My, the graciousness of this moneylender to just look at these two that owe this sum and say, you're forgiven. I cancel the debt. I'm going to write the check myself. What does that say about the greatness of our God? Friend, listen, when it comes to our debt of sin, God doesn't overlook our sin. God doesn't just wink at it. God doesn't just pass over it. What does God do? God forgives it. How? By His Son Christ paying the penalty for it. And no wonder that verse 47, and boy, it makes that verse just leap off the page and come alive when it says, therefore I say to you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven. For she loved much, to whom little is forgiven, the same loves little. In other words, the one who gets it, who understands it, who sees the depth of the depravity in their heart, who sees that they have such a debt that they could never possibly pay for that. They couldn't do enough good stuff to get out of that debt. They couldn't serve enough people to get out of that debt. They couldn't attend enough worship services to get out of that debt. They could not be baptized enough to get out of that debt. And they understand they're guilty standing before a holy God. And then to realize that God in Christ forgave me of that debt. I tell you, that'll make you jump up and say hallelujah, even if you are a Baptist. That's what the gospel does for us. And you see, some people never worship because they just try to get the cart before the horse. They just try to go through the motions. But there's no meaning that springs from the heart of having a relationship with this risen Christ. You know the old saying, I owed a debt I could not pay. He paid a debt he did not owe. And that's the motivation for our worship. My friend, I've heard preachers preach from this passage and just mess it all up. She was not saved because of her tears. She was not saved because she gave Jesus an expensive gift. She was not saved because of her love. She was saved because of one thing, her faith. That's what Jesus said down in verse number 50. He said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you." So she was saved by faith, maybe in Matthew 11, verses 28 through 30. I don't know. And now she comes and there are the works of worship. It always works that way, always. There's never worship, or there's never work and then worship. It's always worship and then work. Ephesians chapter 2, "For by grace are you saved through faith. It is not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. But we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, born again for the purpose of good works." That's the pattern. And how in the world did this woman know that she was saved? Jesus told her. You see that in verse 50? Jesus told her, "Your sins are forgiven you. Go in peace." How do we know that we are saved? Do you need some assurance of that? God's Word tells us. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18, "Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall be as wool." God's Word gives us that assurance. Need some more assurance? Stay in the book of Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 43, verse 25, "I, even I, am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake. And I will not remember your sins. Put me in remembrance. Let us contend together. State your case that you may be acquitted." Need some more assurance? Stay in the book of Isaiah, chapter 55, verses 6 and 7. "Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord and he will have mercy on him. And to our God, for he will abundantly pardon." Need some more assurance? John 6, verse 47, Jesus said, "Truly, truly, I say unto you, he who believes in me has everlasting life." That's the gospel. But you know, the serious note is that the offer can be made, the pardon can be available, and yet it can be rejected. In 1830, there was a man by the name of George Wilson. George Wilson was arrested for mail theft. The penalty of his crime was hanging. After some time had passed, President Andrew Jackson gave Wilson a pardon. But the kicker is that Wilson refused to accept the pardon. And so the authorities were puzzled. What are we going to do? He's been given a pardon. Should we set him free? Or should we hang him? And so they consulted Chief Justice John Marshall, who handed down this decision. He said, "A pardon is a slip of paper. The value, which is determined by the acceptance of the person to be pardoned. If it is refused, it is no pardon. And George Wilson must be hanged." God says to the world, "I have provided a way for every person to be pardoned. It's the cross of Christ. It's the gospel. But that has to be accepted. And if it is rejected, even though the pardon was there, then it will do that person no good." Wouldn't it be a terrible thing to end up this life, look back and say, "Wow, I didn't have to be hung, but I am. Friend, the gospel is the only thing that we need to have that pardon. Have you received the gospel? Believe the message, receive the man into your heart. Have you? Would you stand, please? Our heads are bowed, eyes closed, no one looking around. You're saying, well, Pastor, I sure have been thinking about, I need to be saved. I need to trust Jesus. I need to be born again. I want to do that today. Well, all you have to do is come forward, tell one of our counselors that will be at the front of the worship center that you want to give your life to Jesus. They'll help you. You're here today. God's led you to be a part of our church family. We invite you to come today to unite with us. Or you just need to pray today. We invite you to do that as well. But Father, we thank you so much for the transforming power of Jesus and His gospel. We thank you that it has changed a lot of lives in this building today. I pray for that one who is in need of a changed life, in need of getting rid of sin. And the result of that is living under the judgment of God because of sin. We don't have to live like that. God, I pray, people would accept the free grace of God that's found in Jesus Christ the Lord. And then for those that you've said, I want you to put your life in this church and help this church to reach others with this good news of the gospel. May they come today as well. In Jesus' name I pray.